Welcome to worship this morning. Thank you for joining us. We are here, heart to heart, spiritually connected, even though physically distant. And that is one of the beautiful and powerful things about the life of faith, is that we get to know ourselves connected to one another and to God through God's love, through God's Spirit. Today we have a special guest with us. Our guest preacher is the Reverend Dr. Tony Bynum, who is the conference minister at the Disciples of Christ. We recently, this year, we officially joined under care with the Disciples of Christ, so we are now dually affiliated with both the UCC, the United Church of Christ, and the Disciples of Christ. And so, as we were preparing for this Sunday, as part of our series of Songs to Live By, one of the songs that our Minister of Music, Andrew, and I had chosen is this beautiful song, which is honestly one of my favorite hymns ever. Christians, let us love one another. And the melody is haunting and evocative, and the words are so powerful and so foundational for who we are. Jesus is our life, he's our food, God is love, and it's in this love that we are redeemed, that we are one. Now, the Disciples of Christ has, as part of their liturgy, communion every Sunday, which is what we usually also do when we gather together. And so I asked Reverend Bynum to preach today because of the deep passion for the feast of love that is part of the Disciples of Christ history and liturgy and has been part of Woodside Village Church for so many years as well. Will you join me as we begin together today in prayer? Creator God, thank you so much for your life, which is moving in us. Thank you for the gift of life which you have given us. And thank you for the food that we need, the spiritual food that enables us to grow in our hearts, in our minds, to grow in love, to grow in peace, to grow in understanding, to grow in compassion, to grow in awareness, to grow in wisdom. Let us receive your food today. Let us drink from your cup. Let our souls and spirits and minds and bodies be nourished as we join together today in worship. May it be so. Amen. Amen.
Today's reading comes from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 35 to 39. Listen for the word of God. So don't throw away your confidence in the Lord. Remember the great reward it brings you. You need endurance so that you will continue to do the will of God. Then you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, the coming one will come and will not delay. My righteous one shall live by faith. And I take no pleasure in anyone who shrinks back. But we are not among those who shrink back and are destroyed. We are among those who have faith, whose souls shall be saved. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for the invitation to be with you in worship this morning. I know that I speak for all of us in the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, in Northern California and Nevada, when I congratulate you for taking the efforts and doing the work necessary to be fully affiliated with our region. We look forward to continuing to work with you, and we look forward to that day when we celebrate your full standing as a congregation of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ of Northern California, Nevada. I'm also happy to be with you this morning in order to give your pastor a well-deserved time of rest. Would you pray with me? Eternal loving God, we thank you for this time of worship, for this moment when we can come together as your people to worship your great name. Be with us in these moments, and as we hear this word, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations and reflections of every one of our hearts might be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Hear this prayer in the matchless and mighty name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. The letter to the Hebrews is a complicated book. We don't know who wrote it. We don't know where the Hebrews were when they first received it. And according to Tom Long, Hebrews may not be a letter at all. He sees it as a sermon in a letter form. He says the main body of Hebrews bears all the marks of an early Christian sermon, a homily of the sort surely preached in many of the first Christian congregations. Not knowing all of the who and the where and the how of Hebrews makes it easier, I think, for us to put ourselves in the room with the people who first heard these words, encouraging them to keep their faith in God. They needed to hear this word of encouragement because the Hebrews were tired. In a time of persecution, they were tired of looking over their shoulders as they gathered for worship, for fear that the Romans would come in, disrupt their worship, and take them away. They were tired of feeling as if their faith in God was not only disrespected, but was also met with hostility and a threat to their freedom and a threat sometimes to their very lives. They were tired. Thanks be to God that here in America, we do not face that kind of religious persecution. And it could be argued that we don't face religious persecution at all. But we are tired too. How tired are we? We are tired enough to act irrationally. Look at the news footage we've seen of late of people having meltdowns because they're asked to do the simple task of wearing a mask in a store. Do we hear the exhaustion and the frustration in these days of parents and administrators and teachers who do not know quite how school's going to begin? Will it be virtual? Will it be in person? Will it be some kind of hybrid? What do working parents do with their children if it's all virtual? Are our children and teachers and administrators safe if they go to school and try to teach and learn in person? We feel the tiredness. We feel it in our lives. We feel it in the church. A few days ago, I read these words from an exhausted pastor. I do not know this pastor personally, but what they say speaks to what I have heard from pastors and lay leaders. The pastor says, "I am tired. I am tired of preaching to a camera. I am tired of not being able to see my congregation. I am tired of shelter at home. I'm tired of masks. I'm tired of having to think ahead to Advent and Christmas and stewardship time and realizing too that those services will likely be virtual. I'm tired of constantly working to keep my congregation healthy and safe." And yet this pastor keeps on working, keeps on doing the work of ministry. The pastor and the people keep showing up. I believe they keep showing up because they understand that one of the cures for our bone-weary, spirit-exhausting tiredness is worship. And so the preacher in Hebrews does what we do. The preacher in Hebrews calls the church to worship. Why worship? Because worship helps us to make sense of what we experience in our daily lives. And Thomas Long gives us five reasons why worship matters. First, we go to worship as a community. Even by this means, when we cannot be in the same room together, we have nevertheless made the decision to take this moment, however we take it, whenever we take it, to sing and pray and hear a word and receive communion, knowing that we are connected to each other as we do. Second, we come together to worship as those who are baptized and forgiven. We gather reassured of God's love and acceptance for us. Never forget that we are the beloved people of God, each one of us loved and deeply cared for by God, and we mirror God's love for us by loving one another. We disciples of Christ have no constitution. Instead, we have a design, the preamble, that those first verses that explain everything about what will follow, says who we are. Among the things it says about who we are is this, that through baptism into Christ, we enter into newness of life and are made one with the whole people of God. Third, we worship to hear and hold on to the promises of God. God has promised that the day is coming when war will be ended, when justice will flow down like a waterfall, when pain and death will be no more. This world in which we live can be harsh and difficult. We can feel like we are living in a hopeless time. But our faith, Christian faith, is about hope. It's about what 1 Peter calls a living hope to which we are called to cling. It is a hope that helps us to make the sacrifices necessary to slowing the spread of COVID-19. It's the hope that helps us to do what is necessary, to dare to believe that racial justice will come, that police brutality will end, that people can be safe in their homes and in their communities, that heavily armed people in camouflage will not occupy American cities. Fourth, when we come to worship, we cannot come only to pray and to sing. But we also come to praise God with deeds of compassion and mercy. We are urged to consider how to provoke one another to good deeds. I had a conversation a few weeks ago with members of 5 congregations in our region, and I was so impressed with the outreach and acts of compassion they are doing. Because of these congregations and your congregation, people are being fed from a community garden. Portable showers are being provided for people to clean their bodies and refresh their spirits. We have a ministry that teaches how caring for the ocean provides the means to care for every one of us in the world. There are ministries being developed that will help people coping with addiction, and others hosting Bible studies and book groups, finding furniture for newly arrived immigrants, and serving as a meeting place for groups in their communities. They are doing the work of compassion and giving meaning to their churches as they seek ways to be involved and engaged. And fifth, we mirror worship as we will know it eternally. Christian worship is a participation here and now in the eternal work and praise of God. It is a foretaste of that eternal worship that is to come. It is as we gather for worship that we find the kind of confidence that Hebrews talks about. We find the trust and the faith that what we do is pleasing to God, and so it is what God wants us to do. Hebrews talks about being confident in our prayer life. Let us then, in confidence, draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. It talks about being confident in our relationship with God so that we can confidently say, "The Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can people do to me?" It is that same confidence that we read about today. We are urged, along with the Hebrews, not to give up our confidence, to keep our trust and faith that God is here with us and that the promises of God can be trusted. And with that confidence, we can stand tall and be the church while we wait for God to do all that God has said God will do. We are called to live faithfully, not to shrink back, to live fearlessly, not to be afraid, so that in worship we can find the courage and strength we need to be God's people in the world, trusting God, worshiping and acting in ways that care for the dignity of all, doing all that we can to make peace and justice real. We are called, as Teresa Hoard Owens, the General Minister and President of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, says. She says, we are called to be the church we say we are. We say that we are disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. Our movement is about Christian unity, which does not mean that we agree all the time on every issue. We believe that every time we gather for worship, however, every time we gather for worship, bread is broken and the cup is poured, and that while there we celebrate with thanksgiving the saving acts and the presence of Christ. We believe that the table is long and wide and that it has as much room as there is for all of us, and just as room was made for us, so we are called to make room for others, knowing that our chairs may not always match. That unity is our strength, and I'm looking forward to being with you in person at Woodside so that we can talk more about who we are together. It is, after all, as the song says, Christians, let us love one another. As we share true living bread, Jesus is our God and our brother. With his flesh and blood, we are fed. Everyone who loves is born of God. Jesus is our life. God is love. The second verse of our hymn declares, we who break this bread are one body. We who share this cup are all one, children of our Father in heaven, sharers of the life of God's Son. Everyone who loves is born of God. Jesus is our life. God is love. In Hebrews 11, there is a list of confident faith keepers, and I will commend that list to you, and I would add these names. I would add among those who kept the faith, John Lewis and C.T. Vivian and Joseph Lowry and Dorothy Day. We can name the living saints such as James Lawson and Dolores Huerta. They join other people of faith who every day put their lives on the line as they stand for equity and justice as role models of the faith. In Hebrews 12, we are encouraged to see these faith keepers and to see them as if they were in this heavenly arena cheering us as we go. They are our cloud of witnesses. They are telling us to keep going, no matter what, to keep the faith, no matter what, no matter how hard things get, to be encouraged, even when it gets hard. Know as they knew. Know who holds you and who keeps you anchored. Indeed, we are not among those who shrink back and so are lost, but are among those who have faith and so are saved. Thanks be to God. May it be so. And may Jesus Christ be praised this day and every day. Amen.
Born of God. is our life, God is love.
Thank you again to Mike Myers for our reading, to Reverend Dr. LaTanya Bynum for our word today, and to our wonderful and beloved music minister, Andrew, for bringing us special music each week. Everyone who loves is born of God. Jesus is our life, God is love. And now, in the name of the Creator of all life, and of the Holy Lord Jesus Christ, and of the Holy Spirit, go forth in peace, knowing who you are, knowing whose you are, ready to love and serve the world. Amen. Thank you.